Tate House has been demolished, no longer an entity. I think that if you're going to put a studio in a house, that was one of the best places I could imagine doing it, aside from the fact that it was in L.A. I wouldn't do it again just because I don't like working out of my house. I mean, it was okay. It wasn't. I'm glad I did it, but I've done it, and I'm going to do it again.
Without sounding jive, I will say it's kind of a joy to tour when we did, because it always ended up being pretty sincere. You know, mm-hmm. There's times you go on stage, yeah. You don't want to be on stage. Yeah. You're sick, you're tired, you're drunk. But it would always kick into gear somehow, where you always ended up meaning what you were saying, and the anger or the whole release was genuine. If the crowd sucked, you were mad at them. You know, the crowd was good, then there was more reasons. If you see 40 people yelling back at you, yelling the lyric, it was kind of a cool thing. And it always ended up being that way. And it just got less concerned about playing the right notes and doing the right thing and just beating the fuck out of these songs. We use tape when we play live. Because just due to the way that computers and MIDI and samplers tend to work live on stage, and the last thing you want is, why is it not working? Well, is it the computer? Is it the hard disk? Is it the MIDI cable? Is it the MIDI interface? Is it the sampler? Is it the power cord of the sampler? Is it the D51 sampler? Is it the fuck, you know what I mean? I've seen some electronic bands go out live and then just take a full fucking rock band with live acoustic drums and two guitars and 10 guys playing keyboards. Fuck that. I like the sound of drum machines. I like the sound of sequency bass lines. And if I didn't, I wouldn't have made my record that way. The thing that got bad, just to kind of justify my bitching, was realizing that, you know, Nine Inch Nails got bigger than I ever dreamed it would get. I thought maybe 10 years, you know, we'd be like The Cure someday. And if it hit 6th album, people start to hear about us. As good as you could feel about that, I also knew that the ship was going down because the label, they hated the record I gave them. They put it out, sold a shitload of records. And I thought, maybe, and I can deal with small budgets. I can deal with, you know, being on an independent label. But don't, I mean, let me do what I want to do. I thought maybe when I proved them wrong, they would let me do that. But it turned into a... Well, now, you sold 1 million records, we're going to sell 5 million on the next one. We're going to make sure you got radio-friendly song. And it was like, what, blow me. You know what I mean? Because it would have been the end. I'd rather Nine Inch Nails just vanish with some amount of coolness than here we are now, you know, in a fucking Coke commercial, you know, rapping. They rescued us from TVT. It was the lesser of several evils. And at the time, my vision of Interscope was Marky Mark. It's like, Christ, one TVT to another. But I've really, again, I can't say how cool they've been in the whole situation. So I'm very happy with that. And it's nice to have a label president that was a producer himself and knows how to make a record and knows how you can get stuck and knows how things, you know, don't always go as planned. I'm convinced there are good people somewhere, you know. I would think Daniel Miller is probably a good, and there's people at Sire, you know. that are cool record company people that seem to have some knowledge as to what the fuck's going on, and seem to be in it because they like music, not because, you know, how much money I can make if I, you know what I mean, it's they like music, you know, which is why I make music. If it was to make money, you know, I'd be further ahead working at fucking 7-Eleven, you know, up until last year, you know. My theory originally was just approach small labels, and if we can get a deal to do a 12-inch or an EP or something like that, get a little bit of money and kind of get my shit together before, then go to a big label and say, look, I sold this many records and I had a tiny budget, let me put a record out, but let me do it. Nowadays, I would say, go with a major label. I was on an independent, and I got fucked. All the disadvantages of a major label, with the additional disadvantages of no budgets, no money, no ability to get records in stores. Fuck that, you know? It's just a matter of making music that you think is good, you know? And that's that. And when the label comes at you, this is my music, you know? Sometimes there's people that with some integrity that might have points to raise, you know, that you don't think of, and that makes sense. But to say, hey, grunge is in fashion, so why don't you incorporate, you know, that's ridiculous to even consider that kind of shit. They're the people that make more money than you do when they sell a record. Their job is to figure out how to get people to buy it, you know, but I wouldn't compromise the actual music to fit into some idiot's idea of what they think is going on at the time. I was going around trying to solicit tapes from art schools and just people that have never done videos to see if we could find somebody that hasn't done something that might be a fresher idea and just do something kind of cool that wasn't a music video. And I've always been kind of bored by music videos. They're just little commercials for your music. he just seemed like the perfect guy, and we had a similar aesthetic, and I told him the idea I had for this video. And basically, we weren't concerned about making a film that could be shown on MTV. And we just said, here's an idea, let's just make the coolest thing we can make. It's something that excites the both of us. And what the label said was, you know, hey, you know, if you want to make a video that's got, you know, genital mutilation in it, just don't come back and say, why wasn't this on MTV? And obviously, I realized that. At the time, I was not concerned about heightening people's awareness of Nine Inch Nails, because it kind of gotten a lot bigger than I felt comfortable at the time realizing that it was. I used to be into going and getting weird 12 inches. I had a shock when I went into a mall record store and, like, where's the records? I mean, CD. And I didn't have a CD player. I didn't realize what was happening. It was like, Christ. The only store I ever went in, and I was in Cleveland, was like a cool alternative record type store. Import 12 inches, and you find cool things that you've never seen, and you buy them because the cover looks cool, and you take that $7 risk on, is this Psychic TV record going to suck like all the other ones? Maybe it'll be cool, you know. So I always was into the idea of doing 12 inches. When it came time to be broken out, some people I respected, I just called up and said, hey, you want to do a remix? What are you looking for? Just do anything you want, like Coil. Just, I don't care if it's even any bit of my song. Just go, you know. And we're going to put out a big 12-inch with a bunch of versions that other people did. Jim Thirlwell's a friend of mine, and I always liked what he's done. And it was a way to somewhat collaboratively work with him. You know, I just sent him tape and said, go for it. The idea of Fix was just a fuck around thing. Here's some experiments. If you like them, cool. If you don't, they're not fucking pop radio remixes. So if you're not ready for it, if you like the light side of Nine Inch Nails, you might not want to pick this up. And I've had more people bitch about that thing. Like, sucks. What is this noise? Then don't buy it. It's a remix. Remix. Not the original. Not new songs. Remix. I really got that out of my system with that. I didn't want to make a whole album that sounded like that. I mean, if someone wants to call us an industrial band, I don't care. I don't, to make music, have to label myself as, this is what I am, here's how I have to do it, go, you know. I'm just trying not to back myself into a corner, you know what I mean? Could Ministry ever come out with a light-sounding song, let alone record? And I don't think there's anything wrong with that. However, I don't want to get in a position where all I'm allowed to do now is the heaviest, hardest, meanest, abrasive-sounding shit in the world, because I think it can be just as intense by restraining. And I think the record I'm working on will fuck a lot of people up, because it's not what you're going to expect.
Recording went hand in hand with engineering and learning that more, and not just writing and recording kind of took place at the same time, so it stretched out, and a lot of it was just not being entirely sure of what I wanted to do. You know, with Broken, it was kind of easy to sit down to direction-wise. I wanted to make a really hard guitar-based album or record. It was easier thing to focus on rather than, okay, now I'm going to try to redefine a lot of things and move in 10 directions at once and try to make it sound cohesive and try to not repeat myself and try to write decent songs on top of that. So a lot of it was just trying to figure out what the best way to approach things, and a lot of just noodling. So the benefit of not having a real strict deadline for a record label was the luxury of being in a studio and able to kind of experiment with different things. Fuck yeah. Back when I started off doing it, I kind of had this mindset of, okay, I hate California. Correction, I hate LA. Sooner I can get this fucking thing done, I can get back on the road, I can move around, I can be around people again. The idea of starting an album can seem like such a monumental undertaking. A lot of that has to do with, and this is not talking bad about the guy at all, working with Flood, a record becomes an epic undertaking. I mean, he's worked with a lot of bands who spend a year in studio, you know, doing an album. And when you're in that first couple months of that and you realize that, you know, final mixdown is months and months and months away, you know, it sometimes seems like the end isn't even in sight, even remotely in sight. Then you read an interview where Nirvana recorded their whole album in 2 weeks. I'm not saying that's right or wrong, but I mean, obviously what I'm trying to do in the studio is a far cry from just setting up bass drums and just banging out 10 songs in a couple days. Did a box the last year for a couple reasons. One, just to keep my sanity, and secondly, to try to be truer to what I think I should do musically rather than inevitably trying to cater to what you're expected to do. I'm assuming that it's the type of record that it takes a little more work on the part of the listener. I kind of look at it as the kind of record that is a multiple listening type album. It's better than one year, hopefully. But isn't something that jumps out of your car speakers and says, this is the greatest album that's ever been recorded. Try to make it more of an album that worked as a collection of songs versus, here's the single. You know, here's another single we recorded. It's unrelated, but it's on the same record. You know, try to make something that more worked as a big chunk of music rather than 10 little random snippets. Yeah, I was trying to use dynamics a lot, and also exploring, spending more time working on mood, and also trying to find intensity through restraint rather than smashing over the head with baseball bats for an hour. A lot of the things when I was putting songs together, I was just noodling kind of, and stumble across something that I think was kind of cool. Ridiculous, I mean, I can't do that. Like that piano section in that song. Then I thought, well, fuck it, I'll just do it in the demo and then eventually I'll change it. Well, I realized then that was probably the strongest thing I could do was leave it in. Like that ridiculous fucking solo, guitar solo in Ruiner. When it kicks into the 70s band section in the middle. That just seemed so fucking stupid at the time, but funny. Sitting around trying to come up with a middle section, I came up with that bass. So that was kind of cool, and then somehow the spirit of Pink Floyd entered my system. I started doing this ridiculous solo, but I was recording at the same time, and one chunk of it just popped out, and I thought, oh, this is funny. Okay, now I'll put a really cheesy, like, bad 70s Rod Stewart drum beat on top of it for this funny thing. And said, well, there it is. It made it on. He mixed pretty much the whole record. He's just a great engineer. He has a great working relationship and a good guy. If you're familiar with the shit, you're probably associated more to indie guitar scene. However, he fit right in. A few days of training. No. That's the way I want it to sound. You know, it's supposed to sound like it's broken. Okay. We got along great. Adrian Blue. Stemmed from an idea that Flood and I had of a certain stage of development of the songs where they were pretty much done, but they might need a kick in the ass in a certain direction here and there. So we thought about getting someone else to come in, and again, this is the first for my engineer. We thought Adrian Ballou, who I've always respected in a super musician type of way, as far as someone who I consider a virtuoso, that would be the style of person. So we had come up to the house with his rig, and he was into it. Sat down, I could tell he was kind of nervous, you know, we were petrified, you know. He's like, okay, well, what's the first track? And we picked this Mr. Self-Destruct and the hardest thing we could find. I said, okay, here's the song. What I want you to do is basically just play anything you want. Well, like a rhythm part, anything you want, just play. We'll just record you. We'll go back and record like 5 or 6 tracks that you play. We put it on and really loud, just 200 beats per minute. And come in, you can see him look like, what the fuck? But he started going, and it was awesome. Jesus Christ, what a fucking guitar player. And we left thinking, Christ, we've got 15 new albums worth of material now. But as it turned out, fitting that stuff over what we already had, we didn't use that much of it, really. Snippets, textures, and stuff here and there. But we've got tons of stuff for what will start showing up in 12 inches. Yeah, we're kind of approaching it with modest expectations. Yeah, I'm very curious myself. I'm not really sure how big we are right now, and I think this is a record that it's not the commercial product that I'm sure a record label would hope it would be. I don't think it's chock full of hit singles. It's the record I wanted to make, and I don't feel like I didn't achieve what I wanted to set out to do. And I didn't purposely try to make a record that wasn't full of singles. It's what came out. But I am curious to see what people going to think about it. No, we have no idea what's going to happen, but we're approaching things. We're not expecting the worst, but modest again.
No, there's bands I listen to for different reasons. Like, I was just listening to XTC today, actually. I think they write great songs, you know? They write way better songs than I'll ever know how to write, you know, in terms of a good pop song. I enjoy listening to them for that reason. I even like Jellyfish, you know, because I think they do the same thing. Sometimes I just want to hear a pop song, you know? You know, it's candy, but it's, you know, there's just as much crap goes into that, a well-written one. I've just rediscovered a lot of records that I missed, like old Bowie stuff. I think is amazing. Dory era up to Scary Monsters, you know, some of the coolest shit I've ever heard. Old Iggy Pop, old Lou Reed, Velvet Underground things. Things that I ignored when I was growing up, because people I didn't like liked them, you know. And I just find that to be a lot more rewarding right now to listen to. When you listen to those and try to figure out what was going on at that time when they put those records out, it's like, that's amazing, you know, and they still sound good. That's something I put a lot of emphasis and will continue to, is that I think if you have a core of an interesting song, you can arrange it in any variety of fashion, but it retains something people can grasp onto. You know, with the whole Revolution of Nirvana and all those bands. I think the good that it did was it made the whole wave of Poisons and Motley Crue's look ridiculous.
Yeah.
You know? And I think that the music is a bit more heartfelt and therefore possibly sincere, but by no means is it any sort of new form of music, you know? Maybe they brought a little bit of the, hey, we mean what we're singing about versus living on a prayer bullshit ethic. But to claim that it's some new punk revolution, you know, it's not.
This is a band that could benefit from a situation that meet the following criteria. One, I really believe in them and think they're great. Two, are independent and intelligent enough that they don't need someone to hold their hand constantly through every step of development. And three, could benefit from the machinery of a major label, as in distribution and adequate budgets to get things done, maybe do a video, do tour support, etc., without the negatives of that, which usually is creative control issues. I know what it's like to have your art fucked with constantly. And I know what it's like when you have a vision you're trying to execute, and the company that you're in bed with, now contractually, is doing everything they can to fuck you up because they have their own agenda. Regarding the bands on Nothing, come down to one of two things. We're not actively out trying to sign every band in the world because I've got no desire to be a record label type guy. But I'm in a fortunate position, and if I can offer that to, if I can help somebody out, have them avoid going through what we went through, that's cool, you know, and everything above board, and we're not doing it to rip people off. But we're also gonna try to keep it small to where we can focus in on what we have rather than, you know, I don't really get into it, but I don't want to sign 50 bands and not even know what some of them are doing and things like that. I just want to make sure I'm in a situation where everybody gets the attention they deserve and need. I realize there's a certain element of cliche involved now when, oh, Rockstar gets his own record label. However, we are taking it seriously to where I also realize Nine Inch Nails is a clock ticking. And in its current format, I can't see putting out, doing this 10 years from now, let alone 5 even. It's not something I want my life to be like. I don't want to mutate Nine Inch Nails into middle-agedom. You know? At the same time, perhaps the label could be something to start to focus on in the long term. Maybe 10 years from now, this label is a on its own with a competent roster of people who are keeping it afloat, as well as me getting into more production, which I think I'd rather do in the long run. It's too hard to make records. My life is out of balance at the moment. because I'm their mortal enemy now, is, something they're not going to let you do. And if you are going to do it, then what's in it for them? You know, PVT sucks. Believe me, I made a whole career out of shit-canning PVT, and I will continue it till I fucking die. You mention that name, and off I go. Change them. What are you doing in an earthquake? You know, Chris and I are the most ill-prepared people in America. Hey, do we have any flashlights? No. Do we have any candles? No. Do we have any water? We got a jar of mayonnaise in the refrigerator. You fucking idiot. Doesn't have to sound like a computer. It's a way to record things, manipulate things. And I'm kind of glad that it's looked at with such disdain among musicians, because it's cool. It'll make my record sound that much more different than yours if you're afraid to use technology.
56 input, famous EQ designer, Rupert Neve designed all the EQs and stuff. And, this one's got a lot of cool virtual dynamics and shit that you do on a computer. It's all powered by an Atari computer. And this thing, which is the coolest piece of gear on the earth, which is called the Obermoog, and there's only three of them in the world right now because people that own Obermoog, I think it's Gibson, stopped the making of that. What it basically is a mini Moog, and Oberheim SEM in one famous program that you can run them into each other. And it's totally great, and a friend of mine that fixes my equipment was one of the guys that designed it. I said, hey, I've got one sitting there doing music for a while, so every bass sound I've used so far is like that. It's great. Main thing I use for sampling is S1100, and then each one of those is hooked up to an expander, which is essentially another S1100, so it's like four samplers. Then I got 10 megs in each one of them. You run out of outputs before you do megs. Microwave, which is an old PPG wave in a rack mount. Difficulty use form. Old digital synth is pretty cool sounding. Weird kind of 80s sweeping synth type sound, but it's pretty interesting thing if you use it wrong, which I do.